Hello everyone, very glad to be able to worship with you this morning. I hope you're safe and keeping well. Please do get in touch with me if you want to. My phone number and email will appear on the screen. As Laura always says, stay in touch with her, and if you need any help, either give her a ring or me, we will be glad to hear from you. Let us now turn to our worship this morning. Our call to worship is taken from the book of Psalms, Psalm 31, verses 1 to 5. I come to you, Lord, for protection. Never let me be defeated. You are a righteous God. Save me, I pray. Hear me, save me now. Be my refuge to protect me, my defense to save me. You are my refuge and defense. Guide me and lead me as you have promised. Keep me safe from the trap that has been set for me. Shelter me from danger. I place myself in your care. You will save me, Lord. You are a faithful God. Let us now bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are our Lord and our God, who is merciful, who is compassionate. Lord, we thank you that we have this opportunity to sit together as a family in our own homes. And we are ready to listen to you and listen from you. We know that we have been unfaithful to you in our thoughts and in our actions. And so this morning we ask you to forgive us for the sake of Christ, who gave his life voluntarily in order for us to have free and uninterrupted access to you. And so in his name and through him, we come to you and ask for your forgiveness. Not that we deserve it, but because of your grace. Forgive us all our sins, all our wrongdoings, the things that we have said to offend others, the things that we have said to hurt people. Lord, we know that sometimes we don't want to do this, these things, but because of the influence and power of sin on our lives, we cannot do what we want to do. So this morning, be merciful to us and forgive us for the sake of Christ. And now lead us and guide us, challenge us and help us to rejoice in your presence. For we ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us now sing our first hymn. Our first hymn is Mission Praise number 7, All Creatures of a God and King.
Of our God and King, lift up your voice and let us sing. Alleluia, alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Hallelujah.
Let us now hear our reading. It is taken from the New Testament, Peter's first letter, chapter 2, verses 1 to 10.
Rid yourselves then of all evil. No more lying or hypocrisy or jealousy or insulting language. Be like newborn babies, always thirsty for the pure spiritual milk, so that by drinking it you may grow up and be saved. As the scripture says, you have found out for yourselves how kind the Lord is. Come to the Lord, the living stone rejected by men as worthless, but chosen by God as valuable. Come as living stones, and let yourselves be used in building the spiritual temple, where you will serve as holy priests to offer spiritual and acceptable sacrifices to God through Jesus Christ. For the scripture says, I chose a valuable stone, which I am placing as the cornerstone in Zion, and whoever believes in him will never be disappointed. This stone is of great value for you that believe. But for those who do not believe, the stone which the builders rejected as worthless turned out to be the most important of all. And another scripture says, this is the stone that will make people stumble, the rock that will make them fall. They stumbled because they did not believe in the word. Such was God's will for them. But you are the chosen race, the king's priests, the holy nation, God's own people, chosen to proclaim the wonderful acts of God, who called you out of darkness into his own marvelous light. At one time you were not God's people, but now you are his people. At one time you did not know God's mercy, but now you have received his mercy.
Once again, we worship God, and this time we ask him to open our eyes so that we may be able to see. Mission praise number 544, open my eyes that I may see.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free.
Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me,
morning. I want to reflect on the passage that is read for us, and I want to talk about our true identity as Christians. Now, writing on this subject, Jim Irwin writes, Recognizing Who I Am, in which he points out that our behaviors and our acts in life are determined by our self-perception, our self-worth, and our self-esteem. For instance, if we see ourselves failure, then we wouldn't make much effort to be a successful person. If we see ourselves as victims, then we would allow people to victimize us. On the other hand, if we see ourselves in a positive light, if we see ourselves successful person, then we tend to repeat the successes that we have had in the past. And so our self-worth and our self-perception do have a governing effect on our lives. And so if the source of our self-perception is negative, then it will have a deep negative effect on our life. But if it is a positive source, then it can radically change our lives. The question is, what is our source? Where do we get our identity? I would like to suggest that as Christians, our true identity should come from the Bible, God's Word. In it, we need to see how God looks at us, how He sees us as people. And so this morning, I want to start a new series on this particular theme. For the next few weeks, this particular text will remain our main text. This morning, however, I want to look at verses 9 and 10. Peter says, in the verses that are read for us, Peter describes Jesus as the cornerstone, the foundation of God's house. But he also describes us as chosen people. Now, if we are chosen, what are we chosen for? Well, we are chosen for a special purpose, which I will point out later on. But the very fact that we are chosen should boost our confidence and our self-worth. Why? Because I remember when I was a teenager or a child, we used to play cricket. And what would happen was that two captains will choose their teams. And I always hope that I will be picked up quickly and by the best captain for the best team. However, when sometimes I was not picked quickly and there were less and less people left to be chosen, it really made me really fidgety. And if sometimes I was not picked, it really knocked off my confidence. I didn't feel very well. On the other hand, when I was picked up quickly by the best team, I really felt valued and really felt really happy inside me. And that affected the performance too. And so when Peter says you are a chosen person or chosen race, that means that God looks at us very differently from the world around us. And that should raise our self-esteem and confidence. We are chosen despite the fact that we have flaws in our lives, we have shortcomings, we have insecurities, we are sometimes immature in our thinking, we have disabilities, and yet God accepts us as we are. He invites us to enjoy and rejoice in His presence. No conditions, no restrictions, no strings attached. He chooses us for His team. And He chooses us for His team for a special purpose. What is that special purpose? Well, Peter says that He chose us so that we can have a true fellowship with Him. And so Peter wants to encourage us that unlike people in our lives, perhaps, who have looked at us negatively, who have not seen us of any value. Peter says, you are chosen. God has chosen us. And he has chosen for us for a purpose to live our lives radically differently. Lives that will show that we are in Jesus' team and we want to imitate the way he lived his life. Now, Jesus did say that you are the light of the world. You are the salt of the world. That means we are to savor the world. We need to preserve the world from decay. And we want to show or need to show the way to those who live in darkness. That is the purpose that God has chosen us for. And this, for this very purpose, we will be mocked and we will be discouraged at times. Peter urges his readers in verse 11 to live as strangers and abstain from sinful desires. Continue to be different, continue to be salty, continue to be a light. And so he says, you are the chosen people. Christians should be living a drastically different life from the world around them. So we are chosen. We are special people in God's eyes. Don't let anybody tell you that you are not worth anything. You are a chosen person for the best captain, Jesus Christ himself. And the second thing Peter wants to tell people, he says you are a people for his possession. Well, how much do you think you are worth? Now, I'm not talking about net worth, but worth as a person, self-worth. You see, we should never confuse valuables with value as a person. And to answer the question, how much do you think you are worth? We need to ask another question. And that is, what determines value? Now, there are two things that we need to keep in mind when we talk about worth and value. Value depends on what someone is willing to pay for something. A house, a car, a piece of art. You know, it could be a football season ticket. Whatever it is, the value that we put on something is determined by how much we are willing to pay for it. And so based on this criteria alone, what would we say our value? How much are we worth? Well, the scripture says, you have been bought and paid for by Christ. You belong to him. He owns us. What was paid for you and me? He bought us with his own blood. You see, God saw us so worthy and so valuable that he was willing to send his only son to die for us so that we may have life and life everlasting. The cross proves you and me valuable. God says, I love you this much that I'm willing to give my own son for you. And so, why should we see ourselves valuable? Because we are an incredibly precious to God himself. One cannot begin to comprehend the incredible worth we are to Jesus. You know, in society's value system, we may see ourselves ordinary and not worthy. But to Jesus, we are the most precious treasure in all the world. And so our true identity lies in how God sees us. And Peter wants to encourage us that we are chosen and we are valuable. He has chosen us as our captain. Why wouldn't we want to be in his team? Wouldn't you want to be in his team? A person who values you so much that he's willing to give his life for you? I would encourage you to think about that, to be in his team. Come and join and rejoice and live for him. The life that would savor other people's lives, that would show that you are bought with price. Price that no one else was willing to pay. You are chosen. You are valuable. May God bless to us the preaching of his holy word. Amen. Let us bow our heads and pray now. Jim Martin is going to lead us in this prayer.
Mightiful and merciful God, may your kindness and mercy be known to all. Hear the prayers of all who cry to you. Open the eyes of those who never pray for themselves. Have mercy on those who are in misery. Deal gently with those who are in darkness. Increase the number of those who love and serve you daily. Be gracious to our family and friends who are in pain through illness, hurt or bereavement. In this time of lockdown, we remember the volunteers, the nurses, doctors, hospital staff, the emergency services, fire, police, ambulance, coast guards and the lifeboat operatives. Men and women who may give their lives to keep us safe. As we try to obtain food and necessities, we remember those in other countries around the world, that they may be free from terror, hunger and thirst. We remember those who gave the ultimate sacrifice in wars across the world to give us peace in our time. God of all goodness and grace, you give us confidence, peace and happiness in you. That your will may always be dearer to us than our will, and your pleasure be greater than our pleasure. All that you give us is your free gift to us. You may be thanked for all, praise for all, love for all. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us now conclude our service. Our last hymn is, I Stand Amazed in the Presence of Jesus the Nazarene. Let us sing together. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the presence of the Holy Spirit continue to be with you now and always. Amen.